Today we'll have a clinical and a pharmacotherapeutic lecture on enteric fever. Enteric fever you commonly know as typhoid. Okay? Typhoid fever, it is a rampant these days. In summers it is the most common infections. Despite corona, this is the actual time when you get typhoid. Right? When there is intense heat along with there is dryness in the atmosphere. So you get enteric fever. It is basically in 30-40% of Indian population, basically affecting the young adults. The range may be around 15-35 years of age. Males are more affected than females. And it is an endemic in all the parts of India, especially northern India. The disease is caused by Salmonella typhi. This is the main bacteria which is causing, along with some other paratyphoid bacteria. But Salmonella typhi is the main bacteria, gram negative bacilli. Please check your microbiology, and it is causing. What happens? It infects the GIT. Gastrointestinal tract. It is the basically the mode of infection is orofecal route. Orofecal route is basically when you eat something infected. All the infected things which are harboring Salmonella typhi can be ice creams, infected dairy products, infected milk. So these are sewage leakage. These are causing gut infection. Bacteria basically harbors in Peyer's patches. Peyer's patches, as you all know, is a lymphoid organ which captures the bacteria, and bacteria goes inside the Peyer's patches. This is gut mucosa. These are Peyer's patches. Bacteria harbors here, right? This bacteria can infect the Peyer's patches. When the lymphatic organs, when the host defense fails, what happens? This bacteria causes a deep infection, causes ulcers, typhoid ulcers, which come out here. They start bleeding. There is blood in the stools. Also, this can penetrate the peritoneum. This is mucosa, this is peritoneum. This can infect, go there, and it can cause rupture of intestine. It can cause rupture of intestine and cause peritonitis, which is known as intestinal perforation. It is a cause for intestinal perforation. It is a cause for GI hemorrhage. It can be cause for intestinal ulcers. When it goes inside the bloodstream, it can go to the brain and can cause encephalitis. So typhoid encephalopathy, where typhoid causes encephalitis also. So these are in brief the clinical picture, pathogenesis of typhoid. Patients present with number one, 90% patients present with high grade fever. So these days when we are in the clinics, these patients, when they are coming with high fever, they are very much afraid because corona also has got high fever, not responding to antibiotics. This also has got high fever. Most of them got high fever and they are not responding to antibiotics. So patients are very much afraid whether it is typhoid or corona, and very much confused also. So number one is high fever. Number two, it can cause abdominal pain, rashes. Commonly हिंदी में इसको इन rashes को मोती झाला बोलते हैं. बहुत पतले पतले छोटे 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 से दाने 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 पूरे शरीर पर आ जाते हैं, लाल लाल initially, and it is known as मोती झाला in a common language. So rashes are there, abdominal distension. पेट एकदम फुला फुला सा होगा, abdomen distended hoga, GI hemorrhage can be there, small amount of hemorrhage can be also there. Abdominal pain I already told because of inflammation of the Peyer's patches. Then there can be complications. What are the complications I told? Number one complication is intestinal perforation. The intestine perforates and cause peritonitis, intestinal perforation, which is a surgical emergency. Surgical emergency. And it can be typhoid encephalopathy. The major problem in therapeutics is, pharmacotherapeutics is that typhoid is manageable. But multi-drug resistant typhoid is also coming into scene, and this multi-drug resistant typhoid is a big problem. So, as I told you that all the ethical medicines should have the right dose, right duration of action, of administration, right route of administration, these things, and right total period of giving the drugs. So these four things are very important for these types of chronic infections to be escalated completely. So this is about the epidemiology, pathogenesis and clinical picture. Now coming on to pharmacotherapeutics. Pharmacotherapeutics is basically we treat by two group of drugs. One is quinolones, which was 3 or 4 years back, we were usually using quinolones. Now the mainstay of treatment is third generation cephalosporins. Right? Third generation cephalosporins. So quinolones which were used are basically fluoroquinolones. Fluoroquinolones mainly ofloxacin. Ciprofloxacin was there, but ciprofloxacin, what happened? Because of intense usage, even all the quacks, everyone was using ciprofloxacin, even in small abscesses, small teeth problems, everywhere ciprofloxacin was rampant. When I was an intern, it was used rampantly. So, what happened? It has started showing resistance. Quinolones are acted by inhibiting DNA gyrase. DNA gyrase is an enzyme which causes DNA to mature during cell division. So quinolones basically act through DNA gyrase. So ciprofloxacin, DNA gyrase of the bacteria was very intelligent. It transformed itself, or now the bacteria is, typhoid bacteria is resistant to ciprofloxacin. Even reports of ofloxacin also getting resistance is there, but ofloxacin basically is also toxic. It is toxic for pediatric age group and extremes of ages, geriatric age group, because it causes the metabolism causes CNS toxicity as well as bone toxicity. So ofloxacin and ciprofloxacin have got guarded uses. And third generation cephalosporins, ceftriaxone and cefixime, they are the basic antimicrobials which are used. Ceftriaxone is available intravenously only, and cefixime is available as oral. So these are the two things which are used, third generation cephalosporins, which are now in vogue for usual type of typhoid. What will be your prescription like? Your prescription, name of the patient, age, sex, weight, very important,
insects, very important name, then doctor's name, address, registration number. Okay? Then the sign, prayer to God, that take thou in your hands. The number one thing which you will write is, the first line should always have the best pharmacotherapeutic agent will be, which will be acting around. What will be the first thing? It will be tablet cefixime, because straight away you don't start with injections. Tablet cefixime. If it is a pediatric age group patient, you will give it by 15 to 20 milligram per kg per day, or it should be given 400 milligram BD. 15 to 20 milligram in twice, 2 divided to tablet cefixime. Number 2 is, you have to prescribe the drug when we are asking enteric fever, we are asking typhoid, you should prescribe the drug in full for that patient who is coming to you. So he will be having fever, you will add tablet paracetamol 500 milligram to 650 milligram 6 hourly or 4 hourly, depending on the clinical condition. If the patient is having continuous fever, you can give 4 hourly. If the patient is having simple fever, you can give 6 hourly, or you can give 8 hourly, 8, 6 or 4 hourly, depending on the clinical condition. But when I am going to ask you that prescribe, you will write, if there is age is not pediatric, age is adult, then you will give only prescription, only one prescription, 400 milligram BD is enough, you write. Or you, if you are, it is a pediatric age group, then you have to divide with the body weight, and accordingly you have to write the dose. If the patient is having weight around 10 kgs, then 200 milligram BD. Okay? Third thing you have to give, because there is gastrointestinal bleeding, gastrointestinal bloating, you have to give a PPI, tablet omeprazole 40 milligram once a day. Right? If the patient has vomiting, then you have to write tablet ondansetron 2 milligram BD. Okay? Ondansetron. If the fever is high, if the patient says that fever is not responding, then you have to write tablet mefenamic acid 500 milligram 8 hourly, or 10 milligram per kg 8 hourly. ECM also, if the patient is pediatric, then you have to write 15 milligram per kg per dose 6 hourly or 4 hourly as ambition. So this is the complete prescription. Then Cigna, you have to write cold tap sponging, because the patient is of high fever, you have to write cold tap sponging SOS. When fever is very high, SOS, cold tap sponging. Also, for patients who are having gastrointestinal symptoms, you will advise cold milk and curd. Right? Then your signature, date and time. This is the full prescription for a patient of typhoid fever. Now, secondly, if the patient is multi-drug resistant, if the patient is of typhoid, MDR typhoid, multi-drug resistant typhoid, what treatment would you like to give for multi-resistant typhoid? Because the patient is resistant to quinolones, the patient is resistant to cefixime, the patient is resistant to many things. So whatever, what things you will write? Tablet. Cefixime, you will include cefixime, you will not exclude it. Or initially, the drug of choice for multi-resistant typhoid is injection ceftriaxone. Here, pause.
So
this injection, this MDR typhoid basically is non-responding type of typhoid. When you call multi-resistant typhoid, multi-resistant typhoid is after 10 days of therapeutic failure. You've given the drug for at least 10 days and you see that there is no response in the toxicity of the patient, there is no response in the fever, patient is still complaining about his problems, abdominal discomfort, even pain, and sometimes condition is worsening. Then you have to ask the patient to get intravenous line done. Intravenous line should be administered, and intravenously you have to give ceftriaxone injection. Injection ceftriaxone intravenously has to be given, and it should be 75 milligram per kg per day or 1 gram IV 12 hours, because ceftriaxone is an antibiotic which has got a long duration of action. It is highly plasma protein bound drug, so it has got a long duration of action. It should be given once a day or twice a day maximum. It should not be given more than that. Ceftriaxone injection is the drug of choice, and it should be given in an intravenous infusion. Why in an intravenous infusion? Because intravenous infusion will increase the plasma concentration. It will keep the plasma concentration sustained for a long duration of time. Not intravenous injection, it should be intravenous infusion. Right? A. B. You have to give antipyretics and all the supportive measures. This has to be closely watched. This treatment should be given for 5 days and still there is no improvement, or patient is showing slight improvement, then you have to switch. There should be a switch therapy and you should switch over to cefixime 20 milligram per kg per day or 400 milligram IV per oral 8 hours. Cefixime along with azithromycin. Azithromycin is added with cefixime, and azithromycin 500 milligram OD for 5 days must be given. So this is the usual mainstay of treatment and prescription for a patient of enteric fever and multi-drug resistant typhoid. Students, kindly take it down in your manual, and in the column of typhoid you write the prescription for typhoid for a young adult, and in the column of multi-drug resistant typhoid you write the treatment for multi-drug resistant typhoid. In your notes you can carry out all the clinical pictures and scenarios. Thank you. This is all about enteric. Tomorrow we'll take another small lecture about another disease and its prescription. Bye.